各位先生，各位女士，大家好，我叫欧立德，我是哈佛非正经中国研究中心的主任。今天感到非常的高兴，也非常的荣幸，能欢迎到学校来中国的诺贝尔文学奖作家莫言先生，还有我们在 Charles 河对面的波士顿大学的哈金先生今天来进行演讲和谈话，我们表示热烈的欢迎。I'm going to speak in English for the rest of this short introduction, the rest of the proceedings today will be primarily in Chinese. So the Fairbanks Center has been around for about 60 years. And in those 60 years, we have had the honor of having many distinguished guests on campus. I don't think, however, we have had very many guests who have drawn as large a crowd as today's crowd. So I want to thank each of you also for coming out on such a rainy, cold day. To hear our two speakers. The way that we are going to do things today is as follows. We have asked Mo Yan first to speak for approximately 30 minutes, including translation. And then we have invited Ha Jin to engage in conversation and dialogue with Mo Yan. And we anticipate that this part of the program will last for approximately 40 minutes. Following that, we will open the floor for questions. At that time, if you have a question you would like to ask, we would ask you to come for to one of the mics that we will have set up and to identify yourself. You may ask your question in English. You may ask your question in Chinese. You may ask one question, and we ask that it be a question and not a commentary. Again, please try to keep that short so as to give the opportunity to as many of your fellow audience members as possible. At that point, that will last for about 20 minutes or so. We will then end the formal program. As you see, books are available up at the front for purchase. If you have already purchased your book, you may line up, and our two authors have very graciously agreed to a book signing. So we will get in line for that, and you can have your book signed. We kindly ask that you refrain from any photography during the book signing part. No selfies, please. So our speakers will be speaking in Chinese. Many of you speak Chinese, I think. For those of you who do not, we have translation provided. Our translator for Mo Yan's speech is my colleague in the Department of East Asian Languages and Civilizations, Professor Jia Li. For the conversation, Professor Li will be assisted by one of our very good PhD students in the department, Taryn Chun. I will be introducing David Wong in a moment. Professor Wong will introduce the speakers. Before I do, I would like to say a thank you to the Harvard Coop for being here today, to the First Parish Church for their cooperation in making this beautiful venue available to us. I also want to say a thank you to the Executive Director of the Fairbanks Center, Elizabeth Liao, and to the staff members at the Fairbanks Center who have worked so tirelessly and with such dedication over the last couple of weeks to make this happen. In particular, a shout out to Adrienne Fitzgerald, who has really knocked herself out to pull this all together. To introduce our speakers is my colleague, Professor David Wong, Wang Duwei. His name will be known to many of you. Professor Wong is the Edward C. Henderson Professor of Chinese literature in the Department of East Asian Languages and Civilizations. He is certainly one of the world's great experts on modern Chinese literature, modern Chinese culture, the author of many books, and a very active figure on campus, and also, I may say, one of our most popular teachers. So with that, I will turn the microphone over to Professor Wong, and he will provide an introduction to today's two speakers. Again, thank you very much for coming.
Thank you very much, Mark. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of CCK Foundation for Sinological Studies, I would like to extend my heartfelt welcome to Mr. Mo Yan and Mr. Hajin for visiting Harvard University. This is indeed a great, great opportunity for us to get together to hear two of the greatest writers of 20th and 21st century Chinese literature and Anglophone literature. I probably shouldn't say too much about the achievements of these two writers because I think you are here because you know who they are, what they are. You want to hear more about what they want to talk to us about their literature and their the vision of literature. I just want to use this opportunity to say again that is that this is a great moment for us to celebrate not only two great writers, but also the power of literature. Through writing, these two writers have been able to bear witness to the ups and downs of modern and contemporary Chinese literature. Through literature, they inscribe the happiness and the sadness, pain and the sorrow of Chinese people through this very tumultuous century up to the new century. So today, truly, this is a rare occasion to hear their dialogue. And after Mr. Mo Yan's 30-minute speech, we will just turn to a dialogue between Mr. Mo Yan and Mr. Hajin. Now I would like to switch to Chinese by saying a few words about the event. 各位女士、各位先生，非常感谢大家今天光临现场。那么有两位重要的华裔以及中国的作家哈金先生以及莫言先生呢，来为我们做对话以及专题演讲。我想这两位呢的重要性不需要我再多说，也不需要再多做介绍。 但是在这里呢，我特别要强调，那么由于他们的杰出成就呢，我们再一次见证了语言的力量，我们再一次见证了文学的力量。那么今天呢，首先我们请莫言先生，那么为我们做30分钟的演讲，然后呢，我们请两位呢继续他们的对谈。那么由我个人来主持。 那么刚才欧立德教授已经说明了今天的演讲的规则，那么我想大家呢，那么也就不用我再多在这里累赘的再做介绍。那么现在我们是不是以最热烈的掌声有请莫言先生来为我们做演讲？谢谢。就坐着吧，
就在这里吧。 哎呀，我这个在很多地方做过演讲，但从来没在教堂里做过演讲。I've
made a lot of lectures, but never in a church.
我这个离着上帝这么近啊，得好好说说好话。Before
God, I must speak well and say good things.
但是这个一个人很难保证说出来的每句话都是好话，有时候很可能说了不好的话。 但是我只能保证今天尽量的说真话。It
is very difficult to say always good words. It's hard to promise that, but I can only promise that I will tell the truth today.
我小的时候实际上就有这个作家梦啊，那个时候，中国的这个物质生活还是比较贫困的，因为我的一个邻居告诉我，一个人当了作家可以一天3顿吃饺子。
I already had the dream of becoming a writer when I was a child because I was very hungry as a child, and a neighbor told me that if you become a writer, you can eat dumplings, meat dumplings, 3 times a day.
所以从那个时候起，我就想，长大了以后我要一定要当一个作家。
So that's when I decided that I really want to become a writer someday.
但是在当时的农村，你如果要想写作的话，肯定会被人认为是神经不太好。
But at the time in the countryside, if you wanted to be a writer, people would think you're crazy.
白天要参加那么沉重的体力劳动，晚上一回家以后，这个家里没有电，一团漆黑，是吧？所以几乎是写作是不可能的。
During the day, you have to participate in arduous physical labor, and at night, there's no electricity or light for you to write in.
当时我们的农村青年啊，有一个很大的梦想，就是要当兵。当兵到部队去，可以吃得很好，穿得很好，而且还可以过星期天，有时间可以写作。
So, village children at the time really had the dream of becoming soldiers to join the army because there you can really have Sundays and have the time to write.
我跟大多数的农村青年一样，每年都去报名啊，终于参了军，当了兵，实现了这个一个很大的愿望。
So, like most village kids at the time, every year I would go try to register for the army, hoping to achieve my dream.
这个时候也是中国社会发生了一个巨大的一个转折，就是我们的前领袖毛泽东去世了，中国进入一个新的历史时期，过去很多没有不允许出版的刊物又得到了出版，很多老作家又开始了写作，很多年轻的作家也冒了出来，那么也就在这个时候我开始了写作。
And China was going through a great historical turning point at the time. Our chairman Mao had died, and many old writers were able to resume writing, and many young writers emerged, and also Western literature poured in.
我最初的写作实际上还是按照了这种传统的这种方式啊，要塑造什么正面的革命的英雄的人物啊，用这样一种模式来写的。
My earliest writing still followed the revolutionary model, to featuring protagonists who are only good.
后来呢，这个很多国外的作家的书被翻译成中文出版了，包括美国的海明威啊、福克纳呀、拉丁美洲的马尔克斯等等作家。那么这个时候读了他们的书，我们才感觉到，哎呀，小说原来是可以这样写的，大吃了一惊。
But then foreign writers, Western writers were translated into Chinese, such as Hemingway, Faulkner, and Garcia Marquez, and we realized that you can write novels, you can write fiction this way.
这个时候我们也意识到啊，我们的生活当中也有他们描写的很多的这种荒诞的、荒唐的事情，所以大家都不自觉的在模仿他们的写作。
And then we realized that in our lives there are many absurd and fantastic stories like in their fiction. And so many writers started to imitate these Western writers.
但是大家很快地意识到，这样跟在别人的屁股后边跑，模仿别人的风格是没有出息的。一个作家要想在文坛上站住脚啊，必须写出自己的风格来。
And then we realized that you can't just imitate other writers, you can't follow behind other writers and be influenced by them, but rather develop your own style.
要写出自己的风格来，我想最重要的一点就是要写自己的熟悉的生活，写自己的生活经验。别人没有的生活经验，你写出来了，你的风格自然也就确立了。
To find one's own voice and style, it is essential to write about life that one is familiar with.
所以我想，我之所以成为了现在这样一个作家啊，是跟我的这种生活经验密不可分的。
To become the writer that I am is inseparable from the experiences, my personal experiences.
因为我这个小学上到五年级就被赶出了学校。
I was expelled from elementary school when I was in fifth grade.
所以很小就跟这个大自然建立了密切的联系。
So I established a very close relationship to nature.
从小就放牛啊，放羊啊，也跟动物之间建立了很深厚的感情。
So I began to herd oxen and also sheep and developed a very deep affection for animals.
所以我在很多小说里有关于很多的，有很多的关于动物的描写。
That's why I write so much about animals in my fiction, in my novels.
因为我在写动物的时候也没有感觉到是把他们当人来写的，当我的朋友来写的。
I write about animals as if they were humans, as if they were my friends.
另外，这个由于这个不能上学，就过早的进入了成人的社会，很小的时候就跟很多成年人在一起。
Also because I wasn't in school, I entered adult society very early.
也听他们讲述了很多传奇的故事，历史传奇，什么鬼怪的传说。
I listened to many legends and folk tales.
那么后来有这个广泛的搜求民间的藏书，像中国的传统文学，像《聊斋志异》这些小说。
I also look for classical Chinese fiction in the village.
当然有很多字不认识了，很多字不认识，那就查字典啊。
And of course, I couldn't read a lot of the characters, so I looked in the dictionary.
所以我想，这个像我这样一种经历吧，对我后来的写作是产生了很大的影响的。
These experiences had a great impact on my later development as a writer.
那么，然后也就是刚才我说的，这个后来又阅读了一些西方的文学，就感觉到自己的文学的视野开阔了很多。
And later, Western literature really expanded my perspective on literature.
所以从这个1984年，我写完了一篇叫做这个《秋水》的小说。那么在这个小说里，第一次出现了高米东北乡这一个文学的地理的概念。
So in 1984, I finished a short story called Autumn Water, and the Gaomi Township appeared for the first time in the literary horizon.
从此之后我就感觉到我这个小说的故事是源源不断了，过去是找不到要写的内容，现在感觉到写不过来，很多的事情可以写。
That's when I found my literary source. Before I didn't know what to write about. Now I feel like I have an endless source for my stories.
当然我想一个作家的这种故乡啊，就是文学的故乡跟这个真正的故乡还是区别很大。
There's a great difference between literary hometown and one's real hometown.
这个文学的故乡实际上它是一个开放的一个概念。
A literary hometown is very open. It's an open concept.
也是一个不断的成长的、不断的丰富的一个地理概念。
It is always growing and also being enriched.
因为一个作家的个人经验总是有限的，你把它写完之后，就需要不断的往自己的这种故乡经验里面添加新的内容。
A writer's personal experience is extremely limited, so this literary hometown is always growing over time.
那么这个时候就发生在这个天南海北的国内国外的很多的故事都被移植到我的故乡里来了，就是。
So I transplanted many other stories that happened abroad and also in China and elsewhere into my hometown.
不但是故事可以移植，就像自然的风光、自然的景物也可以移植。
Not only could stories be transplanted, but also many scenes and nature and creatures could be transplanted.
我这个真正的故乡实际上是这个很平坦的平原啊，一马平川，连一个山包的小山包都没有。但是在我的小说里边，我描写了很多的高达海拔几百米的大山，几千米的大山。
So in my real hometown, it's full of flat plains. There are no mountains. But in my fiction, I write about high mountains and ranges.
我的家乡里边只有一条河，干，但是它已经干了很多三十多年了，一直没有水。
In my hometown, there is only one river, and it has dried up for 30 years.
但是在我的小说里，这条河这个一直是水量很多，像长江黄河一样。
But in my fiction, this river is filled with water, like the Yangtze River and the Yellow River.
所以我想这样一种写作，实际上是看起来在写故乡，实际上也是在写世界。
So such a writing, it looks as if I'm writing about my hometown, but in fact, I'm writing about the world.
看起来是在写家乡的人和事，但实际上也是在写天南海北的全世界的人和事。
It looks as if I'm writing about the villagers and people I know, but in fact, I'm writing about everything happening in the world.
有时候看起来写的是我个人的故事啊，实际上也是写了天下人的故事。
When I'm writing a story, a personal story, it's also a story about mankind.
哎呀，我这个王德威老师有一个学生一考试就发烧，我是一演讲就冒汗。
So Professor Wang's students, when they have exams, they get a fever, and when I give a speech, I start to sweat.
所以如其说让我一个人在这讲，还不如让我跟哈金先生一块儿聊天比较更有意思，是吧？
Rather than having me give a soliloquy, I would rather have a dialogue with Mr. Ha Jing.
我的演讲到此结束。
This is the end of my lecture.
莫言先生的这个演讲，这个简洁有力。现在呢，我们希望在第二段的这个对谈的时间里面呢，提出更多的问题。那么，希望两位呢做出他们的看法，或者是他们相互交换意见的一个渠道。所以呢，我想在这里，我先用中文那么说明我的一些想法，或者是请教他们的问题。然后呢，我用英文比较简短的方式呢，重复我的话题，那么这两位作家呢，以中文来回答。那么再一次，我们谢谢李杰教授以及 Taryn Chung 陈丽敏女士呢，来替他们做翻译。我想在座的多半的来宾都知道这两位是知名的作家，但是也许并不是每一个人都知道，在他们进入写作的这样的一个职业之前呢，他们两位都曾经是人民解放军的军人。所以我特别好奇的就是，在他们进入写作的生涯之前，那么不论是农村的经验，或者是他们在军队里面的经验呢，对他们后来的创作是不是有什么那么特别的影响呢？ We all recognize the fact that Mr. 莫言 and Mr. Ha Jin are well-established writers.But perhaps some of you don't know the fact that before they became great writers, undertaking the career as writers, they first became, say, soldiers. They actually are serving for the PLA, or People's Liberation Army. For Mr. 莫言, that was 1979, you entered the army, right? 1976, I think you stayed with the army for more than 20 years, 到1997年离开。而哈金先生呢， Mr. Ha Jin, you joined the PLA as early as 1969. So actually, you were far ahead of Mo Yan for about 7 years, right? And then you stayed with the army for 5-6 years. So I believe this is an extraordinary experience for them, and I would like to find out how this experience has affected the way they look at the Chinese reality. 那么是不是就请莫言先生呢先说几句，然后请哈金先生再说几句。
我刚才也讲到了这个当兵啊，对我们当时的农村青年是一个很大的梦想。后来我这个梦想实现了，对我的写作，我觉得也是很有帮助的。
I talked earlier about how joining the army was a dream of us village children, and it really helped me to become a writer.
我想这个全世界实际上这个当过兵的作家实在是太多了，包括美国的海明威啊，什么福克纳都当过兵。
Many writers around the world have been soldiers, including Hemingway.
中国当代作家里边有过当兵的经历的人也很多，像什么王朔呀、刘震云啊、阎连科啊，什么都是部队出身的，都当过兵。
Many Chinese writers too, such as 阎连科、
刘震云。
Sorry.
所以我觉得当兵对我来讲，第一是我刚才讲的，就是他让我有了空余的时间啊。第二个，我觉得让我熟悉了很多武器。
So being a soldier gave me a lot of time, but it also familiarized me with a lot of weapons.
我前几天去那个西点军校参观了，我最感兴趣的就是他那个展览武器那一部分。
So I went to West Point the other day, and I was most interested in the weapons exhibition.
我这个 每到世界各地到了一个地方，我就先问这个地方有没有这个武器的展览馆，有的话一定要去看。
And my first stop in anywhere around the world is a weapons museum.
所以我过去的小说里边有很多的地方，很多部小说里边有战争场面的描写，里面也描写了各种各样的武器。
So I write a lot about battles and wars and describing also many weapons.
这个因为有很多武器是从国外买过去的，到了中国以后。中国老百姓给他起了很多中国话的名字，所以我在写作的时候当然用的是中国的名字，但是翻译者就不明白，我一说不明白，后来我就给他画成图画，告诉他这个枪的形状是这样的。
So many weapons are imported to China, and they had original English names, but then Chinese people would give them Chinese names, but this is very difficult to translate. So.
另外，这个当兵的经历呢，自然就是对战争啊有更多的了解。我想，这个战争呢，也是人类生活当中的非常特殊的一种状态。在战争这种特殊的环境里面，人性的恶和善也得到了最大限度的释放。我想，一个作家是把写人的情感。当做自己的最根本的任务的，那么对描写战争当中的人性，应该是对作家的一个巨大的考验。
So being a soldier means you get to know war, and in the midst of war, human goodness and badness, really human goodness and evil, are really manifested. Through war, you can write about human nature in a special way.
韩建雄是你是哪一年的入伍的？
69年，我是老兵了。
69年，绝对说是老兵了。
但我没待很长时间，我就待5年半。我觉得
5年半也够长的了。所以这个部队的时候，你像我这个当兵76年，我见了75年的兵，就要立刻立正这个敬礼，就要给他这个洗衣服啊。
So the question to Ha Jing was which year he joined the army, and it was 69, and Wei Yan joined the army in 76. At the time, if he met someone who joined the army in 75, he would respect him very much, even washing his clothes.
还是让我们六九年的老兵来讲讲吧。
其实我发现我跟Wei Yan有一个特别相同的地方，就说我们都没上中学。我说这是对作家来说很重要，就说你不得不学，因为你不得不学会自己来用自己的眼光来看问题，看社会。
Actually, I found a very similar point between our experiences, which is that authors must use their own experiences in their writing.
那个我当兵的时候，不过我也很幸运，因为我当兵的时候学校里没有事做，就去。当兵了，但是那个时候中国和苏联在边界上正有摩擦打仗还。
There was a great deal of border clashes between the Soviet Union and China at the time when I joined the army.
但是所以说我们是到前面去的，到叫珲春县，就是我们住得很近，能看到苏联那个瞭望塔。
We were very close to the Soviet Union. We could even see the watchtowers on the other bank.
这样的话就说是。对我来说那是很对我以后的生活和的写作都是很重要的，因为那真是到了边缘的地方，跟普通的战士和村民，因为我们是没有营房，就住在一个朝鲜老乡家里头。第一年
This had a great impact on my later writing. In my first year we actually were living in the homes of Koreans.
不过那个时候我真是没我也不怎么认识字，跟莫言那个先生的情况差不多，其实以后我就离开了，不当炮兵了，以后就当那个电报员，得训练一年才能当电报员。当时也是71年的时候，就有些书可以看了，那个就是写《三国演义》啊，那些古典文学已经可以重印了。我买了一本《三国演义》，头两页看了6个小时，不认识字儿。
I didn't know a lot of words at the time, and when I, in 1971, I was already in charge of telegrams.
Yes.
And at the time, I was able to read a lot of new literature.
因为你一个做发电报吧，那个这样的话，你有自己的小屋子，所以说我有四年是做那个事情，这样我读了很多书，但是我不认识那些字，我就把那个新华字典从头到尾看了一遍，从那以后开始认识字了就。
So I had a little cabin to myself to read, and but I, there were a lot of words I didn't know, so I actually read the dictionary from cover to cover, and then after that, I was able to read a lot of these.
所以说这只是一个开始，不过以后呢，就是说写作的时候，我会总意识到一些边缘的一些那个人民，和生活的质量。还有一个问题就是，我看了好多就普通的士兵，男士兵和女士兵。他们都是很有生命力的，只是生活当中没有机会。他们确实是有能力的人，就是没有机会。说我总是觉得自己很幸运，比他们要幸运多了。
And as a soldier, I was able to observe a lot of people's lives, especially the lives of male and female soldiers. They were full of vitality, but they weren't always a sorry.
Vitality, full of vitality. Yeah.And I think, Mo Yan, you know, I think you became an officer. 你是 sorry, 你以后成了那个，你成了军那个，你成了干部了是吧？成军官了。
我后来这个。
You become a cadre later.
我是1976年当兵，然后一直到了1982年，才提成了这个教员。
啊，教员。
So I was promoted in 1982.
正牌职教员。$1.52，但是很好的收入。
Okay, I think we probably want to try a different topic here. 我们都知道，哈金先生呢，他是在美国成名的。那么，在1986年来到美国，是吗？85年来到美国。那么当时呢，他是在这个 Brandeis 大学念书。那么他是这个英美文学的专业。但是在这个1989年之后呢，他选择希望以英语来创作，所以我们今天所认识的巴金呢，哈金呢，这个 I'm so sorry for this 我们今天认识的哈金先生呢，主要是以英语创作的一位所谓的这个 Anglophone 的作家，所以这个地方的语言是一个特别有趣的话题。那么同时呢，这个莫言先生呢，他的语言，我想任何阅读现当代中国文学的读者呢，都有非常深刻的印象。那么是以一种幽默的、华丽的，而且魔幻现实的一个方式呢，来进入到中国的一个多灾多难的这么一个世纪的语境。所以语言对这两位作者呢，都有各种不同的意义。所以也许我在下一个问题呢，想各自请他们呢，就语言的使用和对语言的感性呢，做出评论。My second question has to do with the use of a language and the definition of language. For those who don't speak Chinese, I just stumbled at one moment by calling Mr. Ha Jin, Ba Jin. And we know Ba Jin, Mr. Ba Jin, was a famous writer, particularly in the vein of anarchist literature during the 1930s.But now, of course, we are very proud to have a different Jin, right, as Ha Jin here. And Ha Jin, actually, by definition, is an Anglophone writer. And definitely, we have appreciated his realistic style through which to describe or chronicle the various aspects of Chinese reality, particularly in diaspora. By contrast, Mr. Mo Yan has been known for his very exuberant style.Very, very sort of humorous approach to the misery of Chinese life. So language definitely matters a lot with regard to their approach to Chinese reality, either on the mainland or overseas. So I would like to invite them to comment upon their understanding or their vision of language, either in Chinese or in English. Perhaps we should invite Mr. Ha Jin to say a few words to begin with.
这个语言实际上我学英语很晚，二十岁 那个国内有那个广播讲座，那时候才开始，76年才开始的。
I learned English actually very late when I was 20 years old.
所以说，实际上我这是，也就是说，最后到美国来继续读美国文学，但是我以后89年以后觉得回不去了，就是以后觉得决定用英语写作，这个也是个重新学习这个语言的过程，本来就不是很熟练。要重新用创作的语言来写文学语言来写作，又等于重学这个语言又。
And after coming to the States, I continued learning English, and this process, learning to write a literary language is very different.
实际上，我觉得汉语还是我的第一语言，这是肯定的。因为我最近写了一些诗，我觉出来汉语，就是在很。感觉不一样，还是第一语言，英语还是我的第二语言，可能永远会是这样的。我觉得我自己。
Chinese is still my late native language. I've been writing some poetry in Chinese, and I realize that it's really it feels different.
但就说是一个作家，也是一个普通的人，必须得生存，还有各种各样的责任。所以说我就不得不继续的用英语写下去。已经走这么远了，你就只能一条道走到黑了。
a writer is also just a human being, ordinary person, and since I started writing in English, I decided to continue with it.
但是在英语这个传统当中，有一些伟大的作家，他们的母语不是英语，以后成为最重要的作家。你比方说Joseph Conrad， 还有纳巴科夫和康拉德这些作家，就是我认为我还是在这一个传统当中。
Among Anglophone writers, there are actually quite a few who did not have English as their first language, such as Joseph Conrad, and I consider myself among those ranks.
但是说这个问题也不是那么简单。你说是有没有这个就是一种负罪感呢？也有，因为我觉得汉语有很多很多机会。实际上，我要是如果用汉语写作的话，我可能我会集中写诗。不写小说，但是你的生存，因为我现在教书就是小说是我是挑大梁的在 BU， 这个不得不做下去的，就是说有各种各样的因素，说只能在这条道继续往前走。
So if I were writing in Chinese, I would write mostly poetry. But because of for the sake of survival, it's very important to write novels. That sells much better.
大概就是情况。我姐我很非常羡慕莫言。先生，实际上我读研究生的时候，莫言已经开始出名了，我就非常羡慕。八十年代中旬他就开始那个发表短篇小说，就说是那种自如，在用英语说 at home， 就是在自己语言当中，像在自己家里一样那种安静和那种自如，是我是没有这个缘分的。
I'm very envious of Mo Yan. I already knew his work in grad school in the mid-1980s. His work had been published at the time. And he mentioned that being in one's own literary language is as if one is at home. And that kind of serenity is something I'm envious of.
这个哈金先生的这个英文写作在中国文学界早都变成一个传奇了，是一个神话了。
It is already a legend that Mr. Ha Jing is able to write in English, write fiction in English.
因为我一句外语都不懂，所以我对这个能用外语讲话写作的人，那真是敬佩的不得了。
Because I can't speak a word of foreign language, so I really admire people who could write in a foreign language.
因为很多人对我说哈金创造了一种英语。
Many people told me that Ha Jing has created a new English.
更准确的说是他已经形成了他自己的语言风格啊，英语的语言，英文的语言风格。
And developed a new style in English.
当然也有人贬低他。
Of course, some people are not as kind.
他嘛就是把这个汉语的形容词就直接的用英文写出来了，是吧？
Some people say, well, you just use Chinese words and adjectives and then translate them into English.
而这个人还给我举了个例子，比如说我们汉语里有一个成语叫怒发冲冠，是吧？就一个人生气的这个头发竖起来，把帽子都顶起来了。那哈金用英文写，这个人生气的用头发竖起来，把帽子都顶起来了啊。
So there's a kind of a standard phrase in Chinese that means that when is so angry that his hair is standing up, that his hat is like standing on top of his hair. And so Ha Jing just used that phrase and translated that into English. So people thought that was very vivid.
我当然不相信这种说法，那也太简单了，是吧？那这个。
Well, that's way too simplistic.
总而言之，我想这个能够。纯熟的用另外的一种语言来写小说，确实不是一件简单的事情。
It is no easy task to write in a foreign language, to write a novel in a foreign language.
因为当年我也曾经下定决心要学会英语，学了三个月我就退却了，是吧？
So I actually once was determined to learn English, but I gave up.
我每次来这个出国，哎呀就。发誓回中国以后，我什么都不干了，我一定要学外语，学英语。
Every time I leave China and come out to foreign countries, I vow that I'm going to learn English.
这个各种学外语的、学英语的这种录音机、什么收音机，买了一大堆。
I have many cassettes of how to learn for learning English.
每次都是半途而废，跟戒烟一样。
And I gave up every time. It's almost like trying to quit smoking.
所以在此我要向这个哈金表示致敬，真了不得。
So I want to salute Ha Jing again.
这个作家的语言风格确实是作家的文学的一个作家的风格，我觉得主要的确实是表现在语言上。
A writer's style really lies with language.
你像这个我们中国的几个著名的作家，像鲁迅啊、沈从文啊、张爱玲啊，他们首先的区别，我觉得就是在语言上有巨大的区别。
So the great writers of modern China, like 鲁迅、沈从文、张爱玲, the greatest difference between them is lies in their language.
我甚至还说过一段话，我说这个实际上这个小说家啊是比较多的，文学家是很少的。
There are many novelists, but there are very few literary literists.
因为这个小说家嘛，就是讲故事的人，是吧？而文学家是创造了一种文体的人，有他自己独特的文体、语言风格的人。
So novelists can are only write stories. They tell stories, but literary man, I don't know how to translate this phrase, can only, they really create their own language.
而我也说过这个，一个作家的语言风格实际上在他没有成为作家之前就已经确定了。
The language of a writer is actually formed before he becomes a writer.
因为他的出身，他的教育，他的个人的生活经验，是形成他的语言风格的最重要的原因嘛。
So one's background, education, and also personal experiences really shape the language of a writer.
我想我的这种语言风格就离不开我的农村生活经验。
My language cannot be separated from my experience in the village.
首先是我的这个父老乡亲们他们讲的口语。这个我想是我的文学语言的重要的元素。
The dialect spoken by my fellow villagers is a great resource for my literary creation.
第二个就是我们家乡的这些民间的艺人，这些说书的、唱戏的，他们这样的一种语言风格也变成了我小说的重要的元素，我的文学语言的重要元素。
The language of folk storytellers and also theater troupes also became a resource for my language.
然后中国的古典文学啊，像三国、水浒啊、唐诗、宋词、元曲啊，这些东西也是我的文学语言的重要的构成的部分。
Another important component of my literary language is classical Chinese literature, from poetry to drama to novels.
最明显的例子就是我的小很多小说里边都有这种押韵的现象，而且一个韵一直押到很长的很长很长都是用一个韵，这实际上就是从元曲里边学的。
So many of my novels actually have a lot of rhyming patterns, and that comes from Yuan drama.
当然，像这个中国的文革期间这种大字报的语言风格是吧，也对我有影响。
Of course, I've also been influenced by the language of big character posters in the Cultural Revolution.
那种夸张排比，那种不讲道理是吧？这我实际上在小说我的语言里面也有很多对这种语言的戏仿。
There's also quite a bit of exaggeration and irrationality in my language that comes from the Cultural Revolution.
另外再就是这个读了很多的这种翻译成中文的外国文学作品，这种翻译腔调对我也有影响。
Translated fiction, especially the voice of the translator, also affected my language.
当然，我想要分析一个作家的语言风格，实际上是挺麻烦的。
So it's actually no easy task to analyze the language of a writer.
它有多种的这种构成的元素。
There are multiple components to it.
当然，也有作家的这种发明创造，是吧？
Of course, a writer invents and creates.
总而言之，我觉得这个你用汉语写作写得再好，也不如用英文写作。
啊、你这个是这个实际上我跟你的情况正好是相反，每一本书都是没有什么传统，就是得重新想，因为你说那些人都是中国人物都是中国人，他们也不说英语，所以说对我来说每一本书纯粹都是创造的，但是你还不能没有根据，我还得知道就是说在英美文学当中有过什么样的作品已经写过，但是我每一本书一个重要的环节就是用什么风格来写这本书，这需要很长时间才能找到这种风格。
So unlike you, I always start on a blank slate because my characters are Chinese, yet they have to speak English. So how should they speak? I also have to take into account what already exists in the Anglo-American literary canon, and then I have to decide what style to use.
所以这个问题就是我就是每一本书都好像有一种重新开始的感觉，就是说虽然我说过那些伟大的作家像康拉德、纳巴科夫，但是我又不能像他们那样写英语，因为他们那个英语是书面英语，我就想找一种英语就是一看就是外国人写的，同时还比较自然。就是这个能做到我不知道，这是我想象的一种语言。
So I actually have to start over with every book, and I mentioned Joseph Conrad and Nabokov, but they write in a very literary language. I have to write in another kind of language. It has to sound like a foreigner, and yet
natural.
yet also sound very natural.
难度可想而知。
好的，我想我们下面再换一个话题。那么我现在想问一个更大的问题，就是用中文来讲，什么是文学？为什么要创作？到底为什么到了今天这样的一个时代，还有这样的作家孜孜不倦在创作？文学对他们来言到底是怎么回事呢？那么在莫言先生创作的前些年呢，他的作品常常被拿来和西方的作者来做比附，像是马奎兹 Garcia Marquez， 或者是像是福克纳William Faulkner。 但是最近这些年呢，我们注意他这个对于文学的态度的转变，像他在2006年的这个重要的作品，也是诺贝尔奖这个特别提出来的作品《生死疲劳》这个作品呢，他引用了佛经的典故，那么特别强调了悲悯的一个力量。那么我很好奇，就是这个莫言先生呢，如何用这个悲悯的观念来作为他进入文学的一个管道或是法门？那么相对于此呢，在我个人阅读哈金先生的作品的过程里呢，他对于什么是文学和自由的关系的一种辩证呢，特别花了很多的心思来看待。 那么尤其他有一本著作呢，就叫做《自由生活》（A Free Life）。所以我想，是不是用这两个关键词呢，来请教他们对于什么是悲悯、什么是自由的一些想法 ？My question has to do with their, say, fundamental belief in what is literature or what constitutes literature. In his earlier years, Moyen's works have often been cited to be compared with works by writers such as Gabriel Garcia Marquez or William Faulkner. But in recent years, I have noticed a turn in terms of Moyen's attitude toward literature or the subjects as described in his works. That is, he has taken upon a Buddhist dimension in approach to Chinese humanity. And mercy or compassion, 悲悯, has become a key word for him through, to approach Chinese subject matters. By contrast, Ha Jin seems to have been more engaged with the notion of what is the relationship between freedom and writing. And to cite the title of one of his works, A Free Life, what exactly is freedom? What is the paradoxical terms underneath one's search and inscription of freedom? That would be my concern or curiosity about his works. So I am inviting both writers to describe their belief in what is literature, a big question. All right. 是不是请莫言先做一些这个回答？
因为这个刚才王教授提到这个《生死疲劳》这本书里边涉及到了一个佛教的概念，就是六道轮回。
And so Professor Wang mentioned that life and death is wearing me out has a Buddhist dimension, the notion of reincarnation.
从佛教的理论来讲呢，这个不管是中国人还是美国人，不管是穷人还是富人，实际上都是在苦海里面挣扎。
So according to Buddhism, rich and poor, people in China and abroad, they are all in the midst of suffering. They're living in the midst of suffering.
这个生啊、死啊，不断的这个轮来轮去啊，实际上都还是没有超脱。
Whether it's life or death, it's a continuing cycle.
那么只有进入了这个佛的境界，就彻底觉悟了。就超脱了生死，那个时候才是这个真正的这种幸福的解脱了。
Only when you transcend life and death, then and are in nirvana, then you are you have escaped from this samsara.
所以我想，这个佛教的悲悯就是把这个人世间的一切都看得是很值得同情的。
So in Buddhism, you you see that the material life or this life as being very light.
那我想这个把它这个放得更加现实一点，就我们不要站到佛的那么高的境界，就站在人世上来看人生、看社会。这个悲悯，我想就是对这个人的理解、同情、对人性的尊重啊，这样一些概念，实际上。
Rather than taking the Buddha's perspective, maybe we can look at more from a grassroots perspective, from a human perspective.
这样实际上也涉及到了一个大悲悯和小的悲悯，是吧？我们如果站在一个群体的利益上来看，那很可能就是说，因为群体利益要牺牲一些个人的利益，是吧？那么这样一种就是比较大的，为了让多数人生活得更好一点，会让少数人的自由啊、幸福受到影响，是吧？
Sometimes we say that we can sacrifice a few for the sake of many.
那有时候这个为了追求一个社会的巨大的进步，那么就要牺牲某些少数人的利益，就这样一种个体的跟群体的、个人的跟社会的矛盾，实际上就涉及到了一种人性的这样一种挣扎，人性跟政治之间。人跟社会之间，我想这样一种很复杂的一种关系，你怎么样来研究它，怎么样来描写它，我想就变成了这个文学的一个重要的一个题材了。
And sometimes we say that we sacrifice a few lives for the sake of greater progress, so the human struggle with society becomes a great theme in literature.
那个，我实际上我很多这个特别关于佛教的那个。 莫言先生说的地方，有些地方我也觉得跟也是相同的。你比方说佛教当中要说这个死守善道，像马英九的办公室里头有一副对联，第二句是万事皆空善不空，我觉得这是很重要的，因为文学最终的目的是使人心向善，这是最终的目的。
One of the primary goals of literature is quite similar to the tenets of Buddhism, which is to make good people, to call out the goodness in people's hearts.
所以说，我写作有两个方面吧。简单的说，一方面就是说，使一般的人不注意到的那些人，通过讲他们的故事，使大众能够意识到他们的存在。
There are two aspects in my writing. The first is that I want to bring out the more marginalized voices, the marginalized lives, and who are underrepresented.
另一方面是我自己，对我来说，写作这个本身就是我自己存在的一种方式，因为我们都是从农村，因为我父亲我也是底层的军官，我们就是在最底层上来的人。过来的人，从边缘过来的人，所以说对我们来说，对我自己来说，如果我写作的话，就证明我还活着。
Also, the second point is that writing is a mode of existence. We are coming from the grassroots and from the margins, and as long as I write, I know that I exist.
所以说，就是一种消耗生命的方式而已。
It is a way to spend my life.
好的，非常谢谢。那么。我想下面呢，我想再换一个话题，就是谈到这个文学与社会，尤其政治还有历史的这些脉络之间的关系。那么作为一个中国背景的作家，或者是用中文写作，或者是用英文写作，都不是容易的事情。那么从20世纪到21世纪呢，这个中国所经过的各种政治历史的波折呢，那么给予作家的压力和给予作家的灵感是一样的大的，所以也许我想请教这两位作家，在看待他们自己在写作的过程里面，如何的去平衡对于自己写作信念的坚持，还有他们对于国家、对于政治、对于乡土，还有尤其是哈金先生的例子呢，对于海外漂流的经验，他们有什么说法 ？Literature and politics.Constitutes one of the most important themes and the challenges to all Chinese writers, either in China or overseas. I'm curious about how these two writers have approached this challenging topic through different channels or perspectives, and how the society has responded to their political choice, and how they respond to the various circumstances that either gave rise to different kind of challenges or actually produced surprising inspirations for these writers' creation. 那么是不是请莫言先生做一回答呢？
我想这个任何一个作家都是生活在一个具体的社会生活环境里面，那他的写作肯定脱离不开对这个社会生活环境的描写。
No writer can really be free of the concrete circumstances, historical circumstances of his time.
当然，这个文学本身它也有很多类型，是吧？你像这个写《三国演义》嘛，那就是偏重于历史的描写；你写这个《西游记》，那就更偏重于幻想，写神呐、写鬼啊，是吧？写妖。
But there's also an element of the imagination, whether it's with Three Kingdoms or Journey to the West, where there are many monsters and gods.
那这个有的小说里面，这个作家的表现的，通过小说表明了自己的明确的这种历史观点、政治观点。那有的小说，那么他借说鬼啊、说妖啊，写一些超现实的事物，那作家的观点可能就埋藏得很深。
Some novelists are very, or some writers are very explicit about the history in their works, and some are not.
但是我想，即便是像这个中国的这种神魔小说《西游记》这样的作品，作家的还是有自己的观点在里边，可以看得到的，可以感觉得到的。
But even when a writer is writing about gods and monsters, you can still see the his underlying worldview.
另外一点就是我觉得这个作为一个作家，你用这个文学的方式，就是用小说来反映社会生活，并不是一个最根本的目的。因为小说家，我想通过小说要给读者留下的最深刻的印象的，还是应该这个小说里所描写的、所塑造的人物。
I don't think it is the task of a writer to use fiction to reflect history, but rather to depict vivid characters.
我们这个，比如说我们多年前读过的一篇小说，具体的细节很可能已经忘记了，但是这个小说里的一些主要的人物，我们会记忆的很深刻。
So if we try to remember a novel that we read many years ago, we probably forgot all the historical details, but we would remember the vivid characters.
所以我想这个中国的这种古代作家，像曹雪芹的《红楼梦》，我想他处理文学跟政治、文学跟社会的关系，就处理得非常高明，写得非常好。
So a work like Dream of the Red Chamber has a great relationship to its times, the society and the history of its times.
那按照鲁迅的说法，这《红楼梦》里面好像什么都写了，是吧？政治也写了，经济也写了，官场也写了，色情也写了，神道也写了，就看你是读者站在哪一个角度来理解它。
Well, as Lu Xun said, Dream of the Red Chamber includes almost everything, politics, economics, sex, religion, everything is in it.
但是我想《红楼梦》留给我们读者的印象最深刻的还是那里面像贾宝玉、林黛玉、薛宝钗啊，这些活灵活现的性格鲜明的人物。
But what matters for readers are the vivid characters in the novel.
这就是一个小说的大家高手，值得我学习。
That's the, those are the masterpieces of literature.
我个人的感这个观点吧，是这个文学是不管是一首诗好诗，还是一篇小说，首先是一个艺术品。那这艺术品里头有很多成分，政治社会只是其中的一部分。当然，你要描写人物的话。这都是人民跟人物生活分不开的，你就不得写，是这种情况。
So for literature, whether it's poetry or fiction, it is above all a work of art, and it has many components. Society and history are only some of its components.
因为我想所以说，因为这个情况，如果特别写实的作家呢，你必须得从过历史开始，才能超越历史，从内部开始。当然，你要超现实的作家，也可能就可形而上来做，这都没问题的。
But a writer must start from a historical background in order to transcend it.
但是说，实际上一个要是在我们说所谓的社会政治，在一部伟大作品面前，实际上是渺小的，只不过是一个作品的一部分。比方说刚才。那个孟岩先生提到《红楼梦》，还有一些别的像《聊斋志异》，这个政治已经换了多少波了？这个，社会也换了好多样了，但是这个作品还是在的，是中国人民文化语言当中的财富。
So for work, classical works of literature, of course, they contain elements of its society, its times, and its history. But our times have changed, and these works remain.
所以说，我认为就政治这些都应该从艺术家的角度来说，政治和社会这些实际上都是材料而已。
So politics and history and society are only material for a writer.
好，非常谢谢。因为我们的这个对谈的时间呢逐渐到了尾声，那么我们希望留更多的时间让现场的来宾来提问，那么也许我们在这里呢暂时告一段落，但是在我们开放来宾提问之前呢，请让我再多说两句话。那就是这个作为一个作家呢，这个莫言先生呢曾经引用了大江健三郎，另外的一位亚洲的诺贝尔奖得主，那么大江健三郎呢转述了赫曼·梅尔维尔 Herman Melville 的这个 Moby Dick 的一句话，就是一个作家的责任和他的身份呢是一个信使，是一个报信者，一个 messenger， 而这句话呢来自于圣经的约伯记。 而另外一方面呢，这个哈金先生呢曾经也提过，一个作家他的身份还有他真正发挥能量的地方呢，是他不断移动的位置，他是一个 migrant。 所以我想以这两个关键词呢作为我们今天结束这个部分的一个所谓的提示吧，或者是一个建议，那么留给大家呢更多思考的空间。 To conclude the session of the dialogue between Mr. Ha Jin and Mr. Mo Yan, please allow me to invoke two terms they'd like to invoke with regard to the identity and the vocation as a writer. For Mr. Mo Yan, he has once quoted a famous line from Herman Melville's Moby Dick. The writer for Mr. Mo Yan is he who brings a message to this world, a messenger. Of course, we know the quote is originally from the Book of Job. And on the other hand, Mr. Ha Jin has always argued for the fact that a writer is nothing if he's not a migrant. The writer is continuously shifting his position geopolitically and psychologically and imagistically. So migrant versus messenger. I think these two writers have already demonstrated their contribution to these notions, and certainly they are continually to write more so as to bear witness to their positions with regard to Chinese reality or say the human reality at large. So now I would like to open the floor for question and answer.我们在这个地方呢就开始要邀请在座的现场来宾呢那么提出问题来。那么如果有问题的来宾呢，请您移步到这个我们走道的中间。那么当您提问的时候呢，请先告诉我你们的这个背景或是你们的姓名。那么请大家提问的时候尽量把你们的问题呢缩短在30秒之内，所以这样的话我们可以容纳更多的问题让两位作家来回答。好的，那么我们现在 ，now we are going to open floor for the session of a Q&A. May I ask that those who want to raise questions first identify yourselves and, of course, try to raise your questions as concisely as possible and as short as possible. Thank you. Yeah, yeah.
我叫杜玉平，我是从中国广东外语外贸大学来的福布莱特访问学者。我的老师是 Ron Sulisky 先生，他以前是 Fairbank Center 的，非常感谢。
请问您的问题。
好，非常感谢这个机会。我的问题是，王老师刚才说的给了我很大的启发。两位作家是信使，是一个能够在自由世界移动的。莫言先生从中国的农村移动到城市，还有哈金老师从中国移到外国。我想请二位给我介绍一下，在你们的眼中，想给世界人传达中国是什么样的一个国家，中国文化，然后美国文化和我的研究也非常相关。
非常谢谢。
谢谢。
Jelly.
So the question was about what's the message that you want to transmit about Chinese and American culture?
Yeah. 先请问。
因为我想一个作家用自己的作品向读者传达的信息应该是非常丰富的，是立体的，是综合性的。
The message is very complex and it has many components.
比如说，美国的读者通过我的翻译成英文的著作，可以了解到我所描述的我的故乡的中国的农村的生活。
Americans can learn about a village life in China through my translated fiction.
也可以了解到一部分这个我的小说里的中国描述的中国人，他们的精神状态，他们的这种。希望理想。
They can learn about the dreams and aspirations of the Chinese people in my works.
但是实际上，我更希望的是读者通过读我的书，了解到中国的文学艺术，或者说我个人的文学艺术。
But my greater hope is that they will learn more about Chinese literary tradition and cultural tradition.
Thank you.
我觉得这个Melville 他那个。信使这个说法实际上也是小说当中一个很重要的原则，就是说带来世界的消息。Yes, 带来世界的消息 bring the news for the world.
Bring news of the world.
对，但是这个问就说对我来说，这个更重要一个层次，就是说这个世界的消息更重要是从人心来的消息。
The more important message comes from the human heart.
所以说对我来说，我并不对哪个国家哪个地域感兴趣，我最感兴趣是我的故事当中能使读者在当中找到他们自己。
I'm less interested in portraying a nation than in letting readers find themselves in my works.
好，非常谢谢，请下一位。
莫言老师您好，非常感谢您今天能来跟我们分享这些内容。我叫李瑜，我是哈佛公共卫生学院一年级的学生。我想问您的问题是一个多年的疑惑，就是我读您第一本书的时候，我还是在读高一，然后有一天在学校图书馆里面看到一本书叫《檀香刑》，然后我就把它拿下来读了。当时我还是一个就心灵非常纯洁的少女。读了这本书以后，就一个月没有缓过来。就我觉得让我所感到非常惊讶的是，不仅仅是在这本书中您所描写的内容，而且就作者有一种愉悦感，有一种就近乎残忍的、近乎冷酷的津津乐道。您在说把这个一个人切多少刀，然后把他凌迟掉，或者说把一个人用一个棍子从后面推到前面，这样，我觉得您在描述这个过程当中，就我想问您是怎么想的？谢谢。
谢谢。
The question is about the cruelty of Mo Yan's fiction because she read this when she was in high school and found sandalwood death extremely cruel and almost delighting in the in its descriptions and wondered what he was thinking at the time.
因为这个《檀香刑》这部小说实际上是一个写了是把一个刽子手作为一个重要的人物来描写的。
Sandalwood death is actually making a protagonist out of an executioner.
那么写这样一个人物，那自然就是要有对他的职业做一些描述。
So of course I have to describe his profession.
我想我在写的时候确实也感觉到有所犹豫，要不要写的这么细。
I did hesitate, should I really go into so much detail?
但是我想一刀不写呢，一点不写，我觉得也很难把这个人物来写的活灵活现。
But without resorting to such details, I can't depict such a vivid character.
所以我个人至今也认为，小说里边有关这些场面的情景的描写是塑造人物的必要。
So I find that such details necessary to depict this a character like him.
那是不是应该这个写的少一点呢？这个可以考虑，是吧
？I can consider writing less.
Okay, 非常感谢。下面一位，请。
我叫岳林，是哈佛大学科学史和科学哲学的博士。我想向尊敬的莫言先生问一个问题：在您最开始创作的时候，是仅仅出于一种个人的兴趣呢，还是也怀有一种对中国社会乃至中国文化的责任感？而获得诺贝尔奖有没有唤醒乃至加强您的这种责任感？谢谢。
谢谢。
The question is whether the motivation for writing is out of personal interest or out of a sense of responsibility towards China and the nation, and whether Nobel Prize even reinforced that sense of responsibility.
我这个刚才我自己演讲的时候，我要说到我今天离上帝这么近，我要说真话，是吧
？Earlier I said that since I'm so close to God, I must speak the truth.
那么这个真话就是您刚才说的这些，我在写作的时候都没想到。
The truth is I never thought about all that whatever you had asked.
因为我想一个作家的写作的动机啊，这实际上就是写作的动机。没有，我刚开始写作的时候，真是没有这么高尚的动机。
I really didn't have any sublime motivations in mind when I began writing.
这个后来那么就像这个得了诺贝尔奖之后，会不会有呢？我想现在依然没有那么高尚的动机。
Even after the Nobel Prize, I don't think I have any noble motivations.
但是我也知道一个作家确实是有责任的。
But I know that a writer has responsibility.
那这个责任就是要用你的全副精力把小说来写好。
And that responsibility is to use all his energy to write a good novel.
只有你拿出好作品来，我想你才能够配称得上是一个作家。
Only when you show good work can you deserve the label of a writer.
那么拿不出好作品来，你这个想的再美妙也没有用。
And it's useless to keep thinking about this.
好的，谢谢，下一位。
汪岩老师你好，哈金老师你好，我是哈佛教育学院的学生啊。然后我的问题是比较轻松的，因为我觉得很多作家在写作的时候他很容易入进去，特别就是在写那个作品的时候整个人就被带入到故事里，然后情感上可能很难抽离，所以但是我觉得您二位就非常的正常而且非常的有趣所以我的问题就是啊，您是怎么平衡这个写作的过程还有您平时日常的生活的，有没有什么很好玩的经历可以跟我们分享一下？
好，谢谢。
The question is about whether the writers have special experiences, special anecdotes when they're writing. How do they balance the life of a writer and everyday life?
对，真是写作过程当中没有什么好玩的经历。
Writing is not so much fun.
因为我想写作有时候会进入一种忘我的状态，一旦忘我以后，自己是个什么样的不知道的。
It's true that sometimes you forget yourself while you're writing.
但是我听我太太也描述过我，就是我在写作的入神的时候啊，会这个恍神，腿会哆嗦。
My wife says that I shiver over when I'm really into my writing.
另外会不断的喘粗气，好像在干什么重活一样。
And I'm breathing very deeply as if I'm engaged in hard labor.
其他的就很难说了。
好，非常谢谢，下一位。好，哈金。
那个，其实我一个很重要的就是我们都是军人出身，这是很重要的。特别写长篇小说，你得能吃苦，确实大那个强烈的劳动，而且还得有纪律性，必须得做下去。我个人呢，我太太我自己不知道，我太太经常说是你写的时候你老在那笑。我自己倒没听到我自己笑，这是过去，这是最好的状态的时候是这样。
Being in the army certainly strengthened our sense of discipline, and I find that when I write, I'm often laughing.
Okay, 好的，谢谢，请下一位。
我叫严静文，是 Salem State University 英文文学专业的研究生，然后我。有一个问题是给莫言先生的，我想问一下，为什么您的书中很多主人公都是出自一个家庭？比如说像《蛙鸭》当中，然后您的主人公是我姑姑，然后其他人也都是一个家庭中的，家庭中的。然后有评论家认为，您这样写把国家暴力对个人生命的尊严的践踏变成了家庭内部纷争，似乎是在叙述一个暴力的故事，实则掩盖了暴力的事实。我想问一下，您对此怎样看？
This is a long question. If you like me to translate myself, I'd like to do that. So,
我就自己翻译一下。
So, I'd like to know why so many characters in 莫言's novel are related. Like in Frog, like the protagonist is my aunt and the other people are in the family. So some critics believe that by doing so, you are changing the violence from the country's civilians to like family arguments. And you're telling a story of violence, but you're hiding the violent facts. And I'd like to know like how Mo Yan thinks of it. Thank you.
Okay, 谢谢。
这个小说嘛，总是有人物原型是吧？我的大部分小说都是有人物原型的。
My fiction is often modeled after real people.
当然，有的时候就像鲁迅讲的，一个人物原型可能来自于好几个现实生活中的人凑起来的。
But some are composite characters.
像这个《我的红高粱》里面的我爷爷、我奶奶，这些人实际上都是很多乡亲们合成的一个人。
So grandpa and grandma in Red Sorghum are composite characters from many of my fellow villagers.
但是蛙里面这个我姑姑，她确实就是只有一个人比较这个个性鲜明的一个原型人物。
But my aunt in Frog is actually based on a particular person.
这个姑姑就是我的爷爷的哥哥的女儿。
He was my grandfather's brother's daughter. She was she, sorry.
她确实是当了一辈子妇产科的医生。
She was truly a gynecologist.
我们这个高米东北乡的这个好几千个孩子都是她接下来的。
She had, she was, gave birth, she helped give birth to thousands of children.
另外她这个本身也很传奇，胆很大，她的。
She was extremely daring.
在我们这个高米东北乡这个鬼话横行的那么一个地方，她经常半夜三更的给人去接生啊，生孩子就来不及等待，是吧？
As a midwife, she often had to go outside in the middle of the night.
而且她的手特别凉，我们一般的人手是热的，她手特别凉。
She had very cold hands.
而且她很会讲故事。
And she told many stories.
所以小的时候我们经常就会跑到她家去啊，听她讲她的遇到这个鬼啊那个鬼啊这么一些事件。
So we often went to her house and she would tell us all these ghost stories.
所以我在这个写这个小说的时候，实际上在这个不是说我要写这个小说，而是因为我这个姑姑，我才决定了要写一个小说。
It's not because I want to write this novel that I find this character, but rather because I want to write about this aunt that I write the novel.
那么一写她的，自然就涉及到了什么计划生育啊，这些一些国家的一些大问题。
Of course, I will touch on questions like the one-child policy.
所以这个写小说有两种写法，一种从大处往小里写。
There are two ways of writing a novel. One is to write about a big issue and then write about details and making that into a microcosm.
一种就是从小处往大里写。
The other is to write about small things and then write about big things from small things.
所以我想蛙是应该属于这种从小处往大里写的小说。
Frog is a novel that it begins with a small detail and extends into larger issues.
Okay, 好的，那么再下一位。
我叫焦小婷，是来自于国内，在这Du Bois Institute 做访学的。我研究的方向是美国黑人文学。我这个问题是问给莫言先生的。我在两个月之前还在国内的时候读到一篇刘在富先生写的评论您的文章，他说您的作品当中带有一种酒神精神的狂欢，说宝是生的狂欢、死的狂欢、酒的狂欢和爱的狂欢。我读过您的《蛙》，我想知道您在这《蛙》这部作品当中，因为计划生育死了很多的婴儿和胎儿，你是如何把死这个问题作为狂欢化的处理的？谢谢。
非常谢谢。
The question is about the carnivalesque in Moyen's works, especially how it is treated in the novel Frog.
我的这个小并不是说我的每一个小说里都有狂欢啊。
Not all my novels are carnivalesque.
蛙里边我觉得就没有多少狂欢。
Also not entirely in Frog.
那如果有的话，就是好像有一个超现实的细节，就是姑姑有一次喝醉了酒，回家的路上碰到了很多这个成群结队的青蛙来追赶她，好像这个有点狂欢。
Well, there is a carnivalesque fantastic detail where aunt is going home and there are a whole bunch of frogs that are following her.
Okay, 谢谢。
好，谢谢。In the interest of time, probably we can accommodate only one more question. It has to be a short question. 因为时间的关系，可能只能再有一个问题。其他的话，那么在场的诸位可能要请你们就特别来包含我们今天时间的压力，好吧？请。
莫言老师好，哈金老师好，王老师好，很高兴我经常去听王老师的课，所以今天也特别荣幸能够。
请问问题。
我知道，就是我今天的问题就是说。您两位都是文学的大家，但我自我介绍一下，简单自我介绍。我是，就是非常简单，就是说我是一个学理工科出来的人，但是很荣幸能够去听很多文学的课。那我也特别喜欢您的书，我自己全套我都买了。所以我的想法就是说，我想请教，就是说您写了这么多关于文学的东西，您对于就是说文化或者文学来讲，您认为您是悲观的，或特别是中国的文化，您是悲观的还是乐观的呢？那您的或者是说另外一点就是说诗歌，我自己很喜欢中国古典的诗歌，我想请教一下你们，就是说小说跟诗歌之间的美学的东西，你们是怎么看的？谢谢。
好，谢谢，
谢王老师。
The two questions are whether they're pessimistic or optimistic about Chinese culture, and the second question is the relationship between between fiction and poetry.
这个话题太大了哈，中国。
They're huge questions.
我反正我对生活，反正有时候悲观，有时候也很乐观。
I'm sometimes pessimistic and sometimes optimistic about life.
诗跟小说的问题，让哈金先生回答吧。他的写
诗的 我跟那个莫言先生一样，实际上你有的时候悲观，有的是乐观，这个都是普通的人一样，是看心情，看这个具体的情况了。但是我觉得有个巨大区别，就是说诗是任何一个好的小说都要有一种诗的精神，这是肯定的。还有一个就是说诗人和小说的那个野心不一样，雄心不一样。诗歌的诗人的雄心是应该在一个语言当中，留下自己的成分。比方说，李白、杜甫，我们现在说的汉语当中还有好多他们的诗行。小说呢，就是要讲一个故事，能深入人心的故事，能够相流传下去的故事。
Okay.
So in terms of the difference between poetry and fiction, they have different ambitions. Good literature should have a poetic element, but poetry leaves a trace in the language. So the great poets of Chinese tradition, they are still in our language, but fiction is a storytelling.
Okay, 非常谢谢。Professor Elliott suggests that we can probably accommodate one more final question. All right.
我的问题非常简单，两位先生，就是，作为一名年轻学者、年轻学子，我的问题是：你们在创作的早期是如何克服技巧上的不足和欠缺，而坚持写下去的？谢谢。
Thank you. 谢谢。
The question is how in the early days of writing, how did you overcome the inadequacies of technique, and how do you keep going as a writer?
哈金老师是教创作的，让他说吧。
问你的经验，
我的经验，要实际上这个真正进入写作状态是不考虑技巧的。
When you're really writing, you don't think about technique.
就是凭着满腔的热情，强行的往前推进。
It is with great enthusiasm that you just keep going.
我记得我在写一部长篇的时候，曾经跟余华商讨过，我说碰到两个技术难点怎么办？余华说越过去。
So when I was writing a novel, long novel, I met Yu Hua and I asked him, I have these technical problems, so what do I do? And he said, jump over them.
那后来我写完了以后就发现越过去这部分实际上是根本不需要写的。
And when I finished, I realized I didn't even need to write that part.
实际上写作一个作者的最大财富就是青春，只要是力气啊，能这个气力比这个技巧更重要，尤其你要写小说，所以说技巧不是重要的。有很多作家是从来没写过小长篇，以后也写出经典著作了。他也就是说，在写作当中，他也能够不断的，就是学会，不要就是说不要太迷信技巧。
Don't be too superstitious about technique. In fact, you can persistence is more important than attention to in the technical details.
还有一个问题，如果一本书是很容易就写的话，那肯定将来不会是什么，就肯定不会是什么好书。
If a book is easy to write, it can't be a good book.
所以一般作家都是想，严肃作家都是想把自己的能力发挥到极致。这种情况下就是非常难，每一本书实际上都比前一本书难。
It's very difficult. Every work, you have to start over, and it's not easy to just to come up with something.
好的，我想我们今天特别感谢莫言先生以及哈金先生呢，那么为我们提供了这么多精彩的、宝贵的创作的意见。那么我们在这里再一次的，请以热烈的掌声谢谢他们。Please join me in thanking Mr. 莫言、Mr. 哈金 for their talks. And we also have books by